and then later was expanded upon by President Bill Clinton in 1997. And what this act did is it offered cash bonuses to the states for every child they adopted out of foster care. So in order to receive the adoption incentive bonuses, local child protective services need more children. They must have merchandise, which is the children, that sells. And you must have plenty so that the buyer can choose. Some counties are known to give 4,000 to 6,000 bonus for each child adopted out to strangers, and an additional 2,000 for special needs children. And, of course, this money just continues to follow the child and follow the child for years and years and years. And the employees work to keep those federal dollars flowing.
And that's why 67% of children nationally, and that happens to be the average in Texas as well, we have the state hearings on this, are on multiple psychotropic drugs, because once they give them a designation, then the cash amount goes way up.
That's right. You're exactly right. You're exactly right. There's a baseline number. There's a baseline number that of expected adoptions based on population for each state. For every child that DHR or Child Protective Services or whatever it's called in your particular state can get adopted, there's this bonus of $4,000 to $6,000.
All right, Senator Schaefer, stay there. I'm sorry, we've got to break. That was a short segment. Long segment coming up. I want to get into what you just talked about, the ordering certain children. We know the blonde-haired, blue-eyed gets the top cash, and that's been confirmed. So they're trafficking in your children. You know, it's hard to talk about this subject, but listeners need to understand something. I've lived it. I've viewed it. I've watched it. I've been to family courts. Here in Austin, it's so corrupt. It's not just little kids they're grabbing. If you're late to class three times in Travis County, they charge you with truancy. Now, the state statute says it's way above 10 unexcused absences in one semester. Last time I checked the law, it changes sometimes. But to the point is, it's a whole bunch of absences. But they have portable buildings built on, and they send these family court judges out, and they call the parents in the morning, and they put this on CBS News. I mean, I knew it was happening, but it was on the news. They commit this crime right out in the open like it's good. And they say, you were late to class, and you're going to sign this agreement, or I'm going to put you in juvenile hall for 6 months. Now, the judge, she goes, for contempt. It was Judge Jean Meir, who has huge facilities named after her. Talk about witch-like. And she was on there going, you understand? You know, with this face on TV, I got to find that clip somewhere. She's like, you understand me? And the dad's like, do what he says. And the kid's crying, I'm sorry, I was late to class. I'm sorry. Then you sign. Now they've got you contractually. That was the trick. She couldn't have put you in jail. Now they've got you contractually, a fur adjudication. Now you're in the system. Now they got you. And it's come out, judges all over the country, getting over $1 million apiece in many cases, to put girls who were late to class in jail in Ohio or in Illinois. A girl wrote something bad about her principal making fun of him, and they arrested her and gave her 6 months in a labor camp. Remember that? We can pull it up right now if you don't believe us. And it turned out the judge was getting over $1 million a year to fill the private prisons, and they were doing kickbacks. Oh, man, keep them coming. Oh, God, the federal money's incredible. Keep them coming. We need more. I mean, this is like Shawshank Redemption. So take my film Endgame, and then we're going to the senator. In there we have a clip from the state senate, and the representative asked her, Susanna Hupp asked her, she says, why do you put 60%+ of the children on Prozac-type drugs? And the head state board psychiatrist says, well, they have bad genes. There's no test for bad genes. They do. They just make it up. Anyways, I got to, ma'am, please continue with the bounties, because we've confirmed these, but you separately brought them up. For folks that don't know, the adoption agencies put out little bounties. This is all even done on the up and up, but there's also a little under the table. Tell us about the bounties on people's children.
Certainly, these children come with bounties because we know the incentives are available there. The federal incentives are available, and they can be $4,000 or $6,000. But actually, there is a beginning formula in which each bonus is multiplied. And this sounds complicated. It really isn't, but this is what the states go by. Each bonus is multiplied by the percentage that the state has managed to exceed its baseline adoption number. Therefore, the states and local communities work hard to reach their goals for increased numbers of adoptions for children in foster care. So, therefore, you get to the end of the year and Child Protective Services Department in some state or in a county there in the state may not have taken as many children as they need to, and they have their formula or their bonus increases on the wall, and it tells exactly how many more children they need by the end of the year.
So it's just like a sales shop at a car dealership. They got the sales manager. You're not going to reach your goal, Bob.
That's exactly right.
In the cases I saw, in this one case, there was this auto mechanic and his young wife, and she had tested positive 3 years before. They don't tell you when you're at the hospital, they're testing your blood, and they go, oh, she's got marijuana in her. No nut judge, no jury, no second test, no process. They come and take the blonde-haired, blue-eyed baby. Well, this is 3 years later, and so they contacted my show, and they said, we're pregnant, we're going back in the hospital, we just want to make sure they don't try to take them. They call. I leave the radio that day. I drive down there. I go in with a camera. The cops say, turn your camera off. I say no. We open the door up, and the cop, and Mike Hansen was a witness to this. The camera doesn't pick it up very well. Mike Hansen was there. He got there even before me, and the cop actually had his hand on her neck making her sign it. You can't make this stuff up. This country's so gone, folks. Because they have special CPS cops just assigned to them who are particularly devilish. And they took the baby off her breast, the newborn baby, disappeared. And then we go to the court. They didn't even fill out the right name. They said the baby was 3 years old and that this lady had done all this abuse. The forms aren't just lies. They're so lazy and so criminal, they don't even care. They just use old forms and have you ever seen that, Senator?
Well, I haven't exactly seen that. I do know that they take children right out of the hospitals, and sometimes they're 1 or 2 days old. But the caseworkers and social workers oftentimes, very often, are guilty of fraud, and they do withhold the evidence, and they fabricate the evidence. And their whole goal is to terminate the parental right of the parents. And parents are just left at the mercy, and all of this in the best interest of the child, those words in the best interest of the child have been redefined. It's not in the best interest of the child. The bottom line is taking the children for money.
And the law was written, for those that don't know, I'd like you to speak to this because I know you're an expert on it, so you can speak to it. It was written to where, oh, we're supposed to keep the family together and give it to grandparents or the other spouse. Grandparents are now don't like how the parents are operating. They advertise on TV to tattle. The grandparents go and tattle, and then they don't get the children 9 times out of 10.
Yes. There are lots of grandparents that cannot get their grandchildren, even when it would be best if the parents are on drugs. Someone does need to have access to those children, but oftentimes the grandparents are turned down. Now, there is a policy that you're supposed to secure a relative immediately for those parents, but oftentimes that relative is never sought out. The grandparents are never given the children, and a stranger then comes in and takes over the lives of those children.
And, ma'am?
And there is absolutely no financial resource or no real drive to unite the family back together, or to keep them together, or to provide any effective care for the family. That is completely gone. Now it's destroying the family.
Well, right out of high school, I learned about this because for the summer I worked for a large carpet cleaning place. And we would go to these houses, because we might go to 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 houses a day sometimes, and I'd say, what is this? And it'd be usually a middle-class house, 5-bedroom. Parts of it'd be nice. There'd be rooms locked. There'd be kids walking around in shorts with their shirts off, ages 3 to 10. There'd be marijuana smoke. There'd be some fat. It always looked the same, some pervert-looking adult. Because you'd be in a two-man team, and I was with the older guy who knew about it. He goes, oh, this is some foster parent house. And I'm not attacking all foster parents, folks, but I saw what it is. It's lazy potheads or alcoholics that get 4 or 5 kids, and that's their business. is they warehouse them, and they're always getting caught killing them or locking them up or giving them one hot dog a day, bread and water, because they want all that money for their drug habit. And that's why I've seen statistics of foster parents being five times more likely to abuse children than any other group.
You're exactly right. That children are much more likely to be abused in foster care than at home with their own parents.